Simon & Schuster Audio presents A Most Wanted Man by John le Carré. Read by Roger Rees.
Chapter 1. A Turkish heavyweight boxing champion, sauntering down a Hamburg street with his mother on his arm, can scarcely be blamed for failing to notice that he is being shadowed by a skinny boy in a black coat. Big Malik, as he was known to his admiring neighborhood, was a giant of a fellow, shaggy, unkempt and genial, with a broad natural grin and black hair bound back in a ponytail and a rolling, free and easy gait that, even without his mother, took up half the pavement. At the age of 20, he was in his own small world a celebrity, and not only for his prowess in the boxing ring. Elected youth representative of his Islamic sports club, three times runner-up in the North German Championship 100-meter butterfly stroke, and, as if all that weren't enough, star goalkeeper of his Saturday soccer team. Like most very large people, he was also more accustomed to being looked at than looking, which is another reason why the skinny boy got away with shadowing him for three successive days and nights. The two men first made eye contact as Melek and his mother, Leyla, emerged from the Al Uma travel shop, fresh from buying air tickets for Melek's sister's wedding in their home village outside Ankara. Melek felt someone's gaze fixed on him, glanced around and came face to face with a tall, desperately thin boy of his own height with a straggly beard, eyes reddened and deep-set, and a long black coat that could have held three magicians. He had a black-and-white keffiyeh around his neck and a tourist's camel-skin saddlebag slung over his shoulder. He stared at Melek, then at Leyla. Then he came back to Melek, never blinking but appealing to him with his fiery, sunken eyes. Yet the boy's air of desperation need not have troubled Melek all that much, since the travel shop was situated at the edge of the main railway station concourse, where every variety of lost soul—German vagrants, Asians, Arabs, Africans, and Turkish, like himself but less fortunate—hung around all day long, not to mention legless men on electric carts, drug sellers and their customers, beggars and their dogs, and a 70-year-old cowboy in a Stetson and silver-studded leather riding breeches. Few had work, and a sprinkling had no business standing on German soil at all, but were at best tolerated under a deliberate policy of destitution, pending their summary deportation usually at dawn. Only new arrivals or the willfully foolhardy took the risk. Cannier illegals gave the station a wide berth. A further good reason to ignore the boy was the classical music that the station authorities boom at full blast over this section of the concourse from a battery of well-aimed loudspeakers. Its purpose, far from spreading feelings of peace and well-being among its listeners, is to send them packing. Despite these impediments, the skinny boy's face imprinted itself on Melek's consciousness, and for a fleeting moment he felt embarrassed by his own happiness. Why on earth should he? Something splendid had just occurred, and he couldn't wait to phone his sister and tell her that their mother, Leyla, after 6 months of tending her dying husband and a year of mourning her heart out for him, was bubbling over with pleasure at the prospect of attending her daughter's wedding and fussing about what to wear and whether the dowry was big enough and the groom as handsome as everybody, including Melek's sister, said he was. So why shouldn't Melek chatter along with his own mother? Which he did, enthusiastically, all the way home. It was the skinny boy's stillness, he decided later. Those lines of age in a face as young as mine. His look of winter on a lovely spring day. That was the Thursday. And on the Friday evening, when Melek and Leyla came out of mosque together, there he was again, the same boy, the same keffiyeh and outsized overcoat, huddled in the shadow of a grimy doorway. This time Melek noticed that there was a sideways list to his skinny body, as if he'd been knocked off true and remained at that angle until somebody told him he could straighten up. And the fiery stare, burning even more brightly than on the previous day, Melek met his gaze head-on, wished he hadn't, and looked away. And the second encounter was all the less probable because Leyla and Melek scarcely ever went to mosque, not even a moderate Turkish language one. Since 9/11, Hamburg's mosques had become dangerous places. Go to the wrong one or the right one and get the wrong imam, and you could find yourself and your family on a police watch list for the rest of your life. Nobody doubted that practically every prayer row contained an informant who was earning his way with the authorities. Nobody was likely to forget, be he Muslim, police spy, or both, that the city-state of Hamburg had been unwitting host to three of the 9/11 hijackers, not to mention their fellow cell members and plotters. Or that Mohammed Atta, who steered the first plane into the Twin Towers, had worshipped his wrathful god in a humble Hamburg mosque. It was also a fact that since her husband's death, Layla and her son had become less observant of their faith. Yes, of course, the old man had been a Muslim and a laic too, but he was a militant supporter of workers' rights, which was why he had been driven out of his homeland. The only reason they'd gone to mosque at all was that Layla, in her impulsive way, had felt a sudden need. She was happy. The weight of her grief was lifting. Yet the first anniversary of her husband's death was approaching. She needed to have a dialogue with him and share the good news. They had already missed the main Friday prayer and could just as well have prayed at home, but Layla's whim was law. Arguing correctly that personal invocations stand a better chance of being heard if they are offered in the evening, she had insisted on attending the last prayer hour of the day, which incidentally meant that the mosque was as good as empty. So, clearly, Melek's second encounter with the skinny boy, like the first, was mere chance. For what else could it be? Or so, in his plain way, the good-hearted Melek reasoned. The next day, being a Saturday, Melek took a bus across town to visit his affluent paternal uncle at the family candle factory. Relationships between his uncle and his father had at times been strained, but since his father's death, he had learned to respect his uncle's friendship. Jumping aboard the bus, whom should he see but the skinny boy sitting below him in the glass shelter, watching him depart? And 6 hours later, when he returned to the same bus stop, the boy was still there, wrapped in his kafir and magician's overcoat, crouched in the same corner of the shelter, waiting. At the sight of him, Melek, who as a rule of life was pledged to love all mankind equally, was seized by an uncharitable aversion. He felt that the skinny boy was accusing him of something, and he resented it. Worse, there was an air of superiority about him, despite his miserable condition. What did he think he was achieving with that ridiculous black coat anyway? That it made him invisible or something? Or was he trying to imply that he was so unfamiliar with our Western ways that he had no idea of the image he created? Either way, Melek determined to shake him off. So instead of going up to him and asking him whether he needed help or was ill, which in other circumstances he might have done, he struck out for home at full stride, confident that the skinny boy stood no chance of keeping up with him. The day was unseasonably hot for spring and the sun was beating off the crowded pavement, yet the skinny boy contrived by some kind of miracle to keep pace with Melek, limping and panting, wheezing and sweating, and now and then jumping in the air as if in pain, but still managing to draw up alongside him at pedestrian crossings. And when Melek let himself into the tiny brick house that, after decades of family scrimping, his mother now owned almost free of debt, he had only to wait a few breaths before the front doorbell chimed its carol on. And when he returned downstairs, there stood the skinny boy on the doorstep, with his saddlebag over his shoulder, and his eyes blazing from the effort of the walk and sweat pouring down his face like summer rain. And in his trembling hand he held a piece of brown cardboard, on which was written in Turkish, "I am a Muslim medical student. I am tired and wish to stay in your house. Isa." And as if to ram the message home, around his wrist a bracelet of fine gold, and dangling from it a tiny gold replica of the Quran. But Melek by now had a full head of outrage. All right, he wasn't the greatest intellect his school had ever seen, but he objected to feeling guilty and inferior and being followed and preyed on by a beggar with attitude. When his father died, Melek had proudly assumed the role of master of the house and his mother's protector, and, as a further assertion of his authority, done what his father had not succeeded in doing before his death. As a second-generation Turkish resident, he had launched himself and his mother on the long, stony road to German citizenship, where every aspect of a family's lifestyle was taken under the microscope, and 8 years of unblemished behavior were the first prerequisite. The last thing he or his mother needed was some deranged vagrant claiming to be a medical student and begging on their doorstep. Get the hell out of here, he ordered the skinny boy, roughly in Turkish, shaping up to him in the doorway. Get out of here, stop following us, and don't come back. Meeting no reaction from the haggard face except a wince, as if it had been struck, Melek repeated his instruction in German. But when he made to slam the door, he discovered Layla standing on the stair behind him, looking over his shoulder at the boy and at the cardboard notice shaking uncontrollably in his hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.